today is very popular to talk about football. One of the coaches from Scotland said that football is not the question of life and death. It's a lot more serious question. Innovation is not a question of death or life, but nowadays is innovation which really drives the progress. Yesterday, a couple of people, including the president of this country, were very explicit on the necessity of concentrating on innovation. Yes, we are a rich country. Yes, we have huge, if not the biggest, natural resources. But only relying on this richness and on our intellectual capital instead of developing innovations and being aggressive, not only dynamic but aggressive in making money, takes us nowhere. So I hope that this session, which we're going to start in a second, will give us a couple of questions, but also will raise a lot of questions and give us a couple of answers. The name of the session is Fast Track to the Success, using Skolkovo as the greatest platform for that. The issue is that when we talk about startups, Skolkovo is a startup itself. When we're trying to tell everybody how to be successful, ourselves we have to learn what is the way to success. On the screen you have a slide which gives you a very quick overview of where we are right now in terms of participants, students, professors, square meters, hectares, and US dollars raised for our R&D centers. I suggest you have a look at this slide and forget about it, because although it gives you a very decent picture, I think it's not even enough to tell, to show, and to explain what are the aspirations of those who launched our project. We enjoy the privilege of having biggest politicians supporting our project, but that is also the risk of Skolkovo, because when they support you, they afterwards have a big question, where we are, and from time to time this question takes to the changes in the management of our foundation. The recent restructuring happened 3 days ago, and I'm quite sure that it's for the success of our Skolkovo, but that's not the topic of today. So we have at the panel, we have a couple of very intelligent people. Sergei, I'm talking about you. Yes. Koron Lenihan. And Sergei Kurilov, who is running Technopark, and Alexei Sitnikov, who is in charge of Skolkovo Tech. Actually, you see the elements of Skolkovo ecosystem, the pillars, as they say in Spanish. So Skoltech, the university, is something which really guarantees the pipeline of talents. Technopark is something which really gives you the tools of how to be successful. And Conor Lenihan is the guy who is in charge of selling foundation abroad. He's the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Skolkovo. And I invite you all to start the open discussion on how and in which way do we go and what can we provide our participants with to guarantee their success. And I would like Alexei to start with a couple of minutes, yes.
Thank you, Sash. Really, just a few words about Skolkovo Tech, or Skoltech, as we choose to call it now. How many of you have heard about this this institute? Could you raise your hands? You know, I'd say we've been alive for about 6 months, so we are probably the youngest university in the 21st century of the recent ones. And Alexander said that Skolkovo is a startup. So Skolkovo Tech is a startup university. It's very hard to describe it in the sense of an established academic institution because it's constantly changing. It's ramping up on so many different fronts that if I start describing each of them, it'd probably take this half hour and then the other two segments of this seminar. So very briefly, what Skolkovo Tech, why we have Skolkovo Tech inside Skolkovo. And actually, before even conceiving the project as a whole, that nobody had any doubts that we should have a university at the center, at the heart of Skolkovo. Because if we don't have it, it's just a bunch of, it's basically, it would be a real estate project with some companies maybe, but there's nothing that will maintain it, will drive the innovation process similar way as it does in, you know, in the known places of innovation, Stanford, MIT, other places in the US and Europe. And so we, but we didn't want to have it too big because it's something that has to grow naturally over the years to become the real driver of innovation. So the numbers that you see on the screen, 1,200 graduate students at the graduate-only university, organized around five themes, the same themes that Skolkovo was organized around, the priority areas. The university will have all the new features which we can have because we're building it from scratch, from greenfield. For instance, we won't have departments, we will have programs. Because those of you familiar with how academic structure is set up in the US, for instance, once you have a department, you have a rigid border that completely, not completely, but significantly limits your ability to do interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary research. So we won't have that. University will be international, just to give you some features. We are striving to have up to, you know, ideally 50%, 40% of international faculty and students, so that we solve another issue that Russian system of higher education has, which is closeness. We're not open. So this is a university, a startup university, in a sense an experiment of how we can organize a university of new type. The double helix model, if you're familiar with it, is education and research. So we have that, but ours is triple helix, which adds innovation to it, and we have a special center on entrepreneurship and innovation inside the model of the university. Not by chance, not in spite, not over time, right there from the beginning to foster and help those ideas that our faculty and grad students create, then to transfer them into companies and successful, we hope, successful startups. So there's nothing, from the outside it looks and feels like a university of a regular type, but on the inside it's really a startup innovative university, a part, an integral part of the Skolkovo ecosystem. And that may be, you know, some call it the cornerstone, the center of it. And we think that this is, of it is a generator of ideas that help the researchers, faculty, students that come to Skolkovo and in the startups that are growing in Technopark to be together and to be constantly in motion, in conversations, in interactions with each other to make this ecosystem work. We are now, as I said, in our about six months, so we're very young. We are starting to, but we have our first group of students recruited. We have our first faculty hired. We have our first research centers. Actually, just a couple of days ago, decisions were made on which research centers will be formed inside Skolkovo Tech. And once our board approves this, we're going to announce the first three centers, research centers, to be formed this year. And as it says on the slide, we're going to be up to 15 large research and development centers, each funded at about $12 million a year for 5 years. So this is a significant effort to those who are familiar of how much research funding buys in terms of dollar per professor and grad students. So that's going to be a significant effort, which we will continue. And we also doing many other things on the faculty and students, forming the Center of Entrepreneurship and Innovation, announcing the first innovation support grants programs for small startups on the seed and pre-seed level to see how the system would work to help them develop better plans and to develop their businesses into successful ones. So this is in a snapshot of Skolkovo Tech. It's really not easy to describe in the course of 5 or 10 minutes because we call it it's an adventure. And everybody who works for Skolkovo Tech works there because it's fun. And it's an opportunity to create something that we've never done before. You know, when I describe this to audiences that are familiar with the Star Trek series, it's when it starts, you know, the Star Trek, when to boldly go where no one's gone before, to seek out new Olden civilizations. That's what we do at Skolkovo Tech every day. And we invite you all to this adventure in different forms, in terms of supporting our innovation programs, doing research to industry with an excellent value proposition, because we are connecting arm of industry to research that lacks in Russia. And we're trying to create this for our research centers. Industry is a participant there always with their tasks and with their needs. And we're now talking to Russian industry, to international industry, to key partners to engage them in this process. So that's in a nutshell.
It's amazingly that when we started Skolkovo, the biggest fear we have was where do we get all the talented people, where do we get all the disciplines, and I have to confess that at an early stage we were running after these companies, trying to persuade them, trying to bring them, even with some, I would say, political discount and logistical discounts, saying, guys, whatever happens, come and join us. Now the picture is different. We have more than 20,000 proposals. 10,000 of those went through the expertise, and we're very selective, and that definitely raises the quality of the participants. And I think the same story is happening with the universities called Tech. The expectation is so high, the foundation so much depends on the success of Skolkovo University that I would say that if you're not yet decided where your kids will study, you have your time with Alexei after this session, please. He's in charge. Now I'd like to invite Sergey Kurilov to say a couple of words about what are the services and the tools Technopark is offering.
Я приветствую всех. Я хотел задать очень простой и емкий вопрос. Сколько предпринимателей или стартапов участников Skolkovo находится в этом зале? Можете поднять руки? Окей. Во-первых, я вас поздравляю с этим. Во-вторых, я хотел бы попросить задавать как можно вопросов именно сегодня. Потому что, как сказал Александр, мы хотели бы построить нашу беседу в большей степени на представлении Skolkovo как некого целостного института, предлагающего наиболее важные услуги, начиная от обучения и заканчивая офисами. Как вы все знаете, а многие из вас уже являются, некоторые из вас уже являются, насколько я вижу, резидентами технопарка. Технопарк Skolkovo – это один из ключевых элементов. Он все улыбается на этой фразе обычно, но это так. Который предлагает вот тот самый пресловутый, наиболее необходимый набор, джентльменский набор сервисов, который, по нашему мнению, помогает компаниям быстро и динамично развиваться. Когда мы начинали этот проект, последнее, что бы я хотел делать, это придумывать что-то с нуля, изобретать велосипед. Мы активно смотрели на международные практики, мы общались с очень правильными, умными людьми, привлекали консультантов, и в итоге пришли к очень простому выводу. Нам придется сделать это с нуля. И тот процесс, который сейчас происходит, это процесс определения методом проб и ошибок, анализа потребностей того огромного количества компаний, которые уже стали участниками Skolkovo, и формулировка вот этого самого пресловутого ценностного приложения, определение того, чего мы можем делать, что мы можем дать компаниям для того, чтобы эти замечательные люди чувствовали себя комфортно и показывали выдающиеся результаты, которые измеряются не только в количестве денег, которые им удалось поднять на рынке, но еще и в некоторых видимых результатах их деятельности. Вот Александр оговорился, сказал очень важную фразу, посмотреть на слайд с целевым состоянием и сразу же его забыть. Но я не могу забыть о том, что через 2 года мы будем иметь огромный, с точки зрения размеров, комплекс зданий технопарка, это 150 тысяч квадратных метров, Я очень хочу, и я искренне верю, что в нем будет жить более 8 тысяч человек, жить и работать. И это накладывает на нас, с одной стороны, огромную ответственность, с другой стороны, делает упражнение очень интересным. В настоящий момент то, над чем мы работаем, это пытаемся выстроить как можно более быстрый и оптимальный процесс работы с участниками. Начиная от приема заявок на оформление виз, потому что не будем забывать, в общем, мы привлекли огромное количество компаний с иностранными работниками. И заканчивая проведением исследований в наших лабораториях, которые уже работают в офисе технопарка, который находится в Сколково. Мне очень интересно получить от присутствующих здесь компаний фидбэк на тему того, что вам кажется работает хорошо, а что работает не оптимально. Если вы готовы уже что-то сказать, пожалуйста, поднимайте руки и либо сейчас, либо как у нас будет отдельное время на вопрос.
It's not your call who has to ask questions, it's me. I'm the moderator, okay?
Sorry, boss. Спасибо.
Before we go to the Q&A session, Connor, please join us in this self-promoting exercise.
I won't talk too long because I am conscious that the people will probably want to ask questions. First of all, my name is Conor Lenehan. I'm in charge of the key partners department at Sculcova, which is that part of Sculcova that's charged with bringing the large global multinational corporates to locate an R&D presence at Sculcova. And I think the message I'd like to get across here today is a very simple one. When I came here at the invitation of Victor Vekselberg last year in April and attended this conference, I think to a certain extent when you spoke to people, Sculcova was a kind of a wonderful, beautiful diagram or a drawing on the wall. It was all yet to happen. And I suppose the message from the last year's activity at Sculcova is that this is a highly operational project now. It's not a notional project. We've managed to attract 20 large global corporates to locate R&D teams at the location. And some of those companies are already hiring the staff and preparing, if you like, to deploy to Sculcova when it hosts the G8 summit in 2014. So there's a big operational pressure on the organization now, very real date or deadline to meet now with that deadline of hosting the G8 summit in 2014. That puts huge pressure on Technopark, my colleagues on the construction side. But it is good news that instead of being a sort of a project-based initiative, it's now very much an operational project. As I said, the 20 companies that have located, they include IBM, Cisco, Honeywell, EADS, EMC, you know, huge global companies. And they're locating and making investments of the order of 100 to 150 million each. That's stretched out between now and 2016. The employment and level of R&D professionals being employed at the site ranges between, in those big companies, is between 25 and 250. There's a very strong cohort of Russian companies locating, private companies, very well-known Russian companies, and they're becoming, in their own right, a source of attraction to the international companies locating at the site. We're hopeful that in the next year, many more Russian companies, both state-owned as well as privately-owned Russian companies, will locate at the site. In terms of the activity, the research activity that these multinationals are performing is very interesting. It reflects the five themes, our scope of research that the Sculcova requires of all companies, be they start scaling or large companies. And the science is very significant and the research is very significant. From my own experience as a Minister for Science, Technology, Innovation in Ireland, we struggled sometimes as a country to attract R&D. In fact, it took us, in many cases, 20 years. And that's 20 years of dealing and negotiating with companies, locating manufacture, and then maybe after a 10-year period of having them bedded down and set in the country, them deploying or moving into performing R&D at our location in Ireland. Here it's the other way around. Russia is basically targeting R&D-rich companies, global corporates, to come and locate and to, if you like, front-load the commitment around R&D. That's not an easy decision to persuade these companies to do. They're in many different locations. But the bottom line, if you like, the reason why they are motivated enough to locate and invest and hire the people is basically threefold. And it's not one or the other. It's a mixture of all three in most cases. It's basically market access. It's talent, the strength and depth of Russian scientific and technological talent. And, of course, it's alignment with a large and very well-backed public project called Skolkovo. And I think that was one of the motivating reasons why I accepted Viktor Vekselberg's offer here, is that I'd previously worked in a small country on the science, technology, innovation end and on promoting investment into Ireland. And what impressed me most about this project last April when asked by Viktor to join it was the strength and the ambition level of the project itself. I mean, there's 4 billion of taxpayers' money being put behind the project. The location itself has been established. The staff are very talented. I'm not trying to flatter my colleagues here, but when I came over for the first week to talk to the senior people in the foundation, it was hugely impressive, the quality of people who are being deployed into the foundation to start doing the business for Russia with regard to Skolkovo. And the other thing, I suppose, apart from the ambition levels, is the fact that you have such a high-profile person like Viktor Vekselberg committing 70% of his time to this public project. That's most unusual in other parts of the world. When I was in government for 14 years, one was lucky if one got a billionaire to give you his PA or his research assistant to work on your project. To have a very high profile business person bring all of his skill sets, entrepreneurial and managerial, behind a public project is most unusual. And that was one of the key reasons why I believed last year when I joined this would be a success. I think in the last year, it crossed from being a pre-trading startup to being an actual fully traded startup. And that's really reflected again, look at Mr. Lupachev there. You know, we have very dynamic partnerships with venture capital, with top performer in terms of R&D here in Russia. And so the networking partnership dimension to the project is going very well. The presence of the large companies, I think Viktor said very clearly and publicly, the presence of those companies is proof that it is succeeding because they don't take these decisions lightly. They're coming for a reason because they think the offer is good at Skolkovo. And I think it's important that people who are from Russia, I'm not from Russia, I'm not a Russian citizen, but I think Russians should be very justifiably proud.
That is easy, and that we can solve it.
Well, thank you very much for the offer.
Consider it granted.
Thank you. What I would say is that, you know, Russian people should be very justifiably proud of this, because I'll tell you a very simple way of explaining why it's relatively easy to sell, for instance, the talent argument to these large companies, is that if you look at Cisco, one of our key partners, when I went to visit their facility in Silicon Valley, one of their personnel said to me that they have 700 Russian scientists and technologists working in their Silicon Valley site alone. And that is not untypical of a lot of large US technology-based companies. So these companies really do know about the strength and depth of Russian talent in the science and technology area. And that's one of the key drivers of their decision to locate at Skolkovo and to locate in Russia generally. So I leave it at that. I hope I haven't gone on too long.
Well, when I was working in Coca-Cola company, I had a chance to talk to CEO of Coca-Cola, Roberto Goisuet, and he asked me, what do you think is the purpose of this company? I said, well, selling Coke worldwide. He said, no, kid, is to make money for the shareholders. Connor, my question would be to you, let's talk, let's discuss. Raise your hands if you have any question. But my question to you, Connor, is, I mean, it's easy to sell the concept of the need of developing the country and how motivated should be all the participants. But I don't believe in that. Really, it's all about money. And when you talk to a representative of a small company abroad in Ireland, for example, coming to him with the concept of, I mean, you should trust in Russia. He doesn't. He don't have to trust in Russia. He has to understand that's the place to make money. That's the place where the comfort is in business environment, in social attitude. Because so far what we see, I mean, the perception is corruption is here. Very special form of democracy is here. and it's minus 30 easily in mid of September. No, September I would, but starting from October. And what are the reasons he should make his decision instead of going west to going east? So, do you think we do enough not to position us ourselves politically, but to really do what I would call FMCG approach, yes, to do a very detailed sales exercise?
Well, I think I spoke in London recently at a conference where His Royal Highness, the Prince of Kent, used the phrase that he was baffled, genuinely baffled at why international investors would invest in China and India ahead of Russia. And I think it does say a lot. I think there is a promotional challenge generally for Russia, but then you have to balance that against the fact that, you know, inward investment grew by 25% here last year. So there is an appetite. There's clearly a lot of companies out there, notwithstanding factors around corruption, bureaucracy, or the operation of the court system in relation to IP. Despite those hurdles and challenges, inward investment is climbing very strongly here in Russia, and it will continue, because the long term, the longitudinal studies on, for instance, WTO accession show that it's actually before you actually fully accede to the WTO and adopt those rules, you get quite a significant surge in investment. This happened in China as well. So I think the landscape is going to be very favorable both for Skolkova and for inward investment into Russia for the foreseeable future, certainly for 5-7 years. I had an interesting presentation the other day, again, by one of these emerging market economists making the presentation in Moscow, but based out of London. And, you know, a lot of the time, I suspect the media coverage of Russia does not do it any favors, even in terms of the figures around capital inflows and outflows. They often actually are misrepresented internationally when you look at the inward investment figures, because obviously if a Russian company, say it's Gazprom, buys a significant asset in Europe, that's actually counted as a capital outflow in many of the figures that you see. So it looks an awful lot bigger than it actually is. And that's a figure that's frequently quoted, in my view, against Russia, you know, that all this capital is leaving Russia, whereas in fact, the picture, when you look at it forensically in terms of the inward investment and the nature of those capital outflows, it's quite a different picture. So there is, I agree with you, there's a huge job of explaining and communicating what's happening in Russia. And, you know, I think that's a challenge to everyone, not just people in Skolkova, but anybody involved in inward investment and promoting the investment opportunity in Russia. But I would say that one of the reassurances for people investing in Skolkova is the fact that it is a separate federal territory with its own juridical and justice scene in its own right. And that's a significant selling point for the project, for investors. They feel and sense that the rules are transparent and they're clear. And, you know, it makes the decision to locate much easier for them, I think.
See, the CEO of Plug and Play, who will join us for the second part of our session, but now he's with the general audience, please.
Thank you. I wanted to say, first of all, I do congratulate you on your approach on the tech park, on the tech university. I think it's a holistic approach. And specifically with Connor, I think it's quite, not easy, but possible to identify 20 big corporations like Cisco, Honeywell, etc. But I think, again, I was wondering if you guys are doing anything similar to Singapore or Chile, Santiago, who have an initiative in attracting foreign startups. And in, you know, very small local market, Singapore has now 3,000 startups. Chile has seed funded 1,000 startups from overseas just to mix in with the local talent and accelerate the knowledge of entrepreneurship. And then the most, which is self-serving, how connected are you to Silicon Valley and the ecosystem there, where, let's say, Singapore and Santiago, Chile, has a bridge between Silicon Valley and their entrepreneurial culture and spirit. So maybe first for Connor.
See, that's why we're having you here. We want you to help us building this bridge, please. And in terms of Santiago, I learned some Spanish, so I'm planning to go there and to learn from them, okay? ¿Está bien? Vamos a hablar en español allá con ellos.
Well, to answer your the very significant question, is Skolkov interested in attracting non-domestic based startups or scaling companies? The answer is yes, absolutely the case. Our investment officer, Alexander Lubachev, is here, but the profile to date amongst the startups is about 80% Russian, 20% foreign, and it's his ambition, again, to leverage a position through his contacts with venture capital, both domestic and overseas, to bring that profile to about 50-50. We believe that would contribute more to the development of the ecosystem or the innovation or the culture of startup at the site. In terms of connections to Silicon Valley, we have extensive connections to Silicon Valley. I'm sure my colleagues will talk about that. But very practical links. We've had, for instance, our IT cluster have had roadshows there. The foundation generally has had roadshows there. A lot of our venture capital partners are from the Valley. And so, yes, we are learning an awful lot. But again, I'm asked, since I came to Skolkov and because of my previous background as a Minister of Science, I'm sort of frequently invited to speak at conferences where you've got people who are so-called experts in innovation. But I think it's clear, people have to be very clear about this, because you always hear things about Singapore, about Ireland, about Finland, about Norway, about Taiwan, Hong Kong, South Korea. You can't make comparisons in the innovation scene. In fact, my view, for what it's worth, on innovation clusters even, you can't just simply import Silicon Valley. And I know the publicity or the hype around Skolkov at the beginning said it was Russia's Silicon Valley. I think the important point here is that there is no way you can replicate that. And I think one of the most interesting points somebody made at a recent conference that I attended was that, it has to be distinct and national. It has to be from the culture of the country if it's going to succeed. You can't just graft Silicon Valley into a location outside Moscow and say it's going to be the same and it's going to be as successful. It will be different, and hopefully it'll be the differences between Silicon Valley and Skolkov that will make that difference for Russia and for Skolkov and the project generally. I'll bring my comments to an end there. I think I've answered the questions around the startup and, of course, the issue about connectedness to Silicon Valley. The extensive research done by the foundation before anything was done in terms of other innovation locations has been very extensive, and I think there is an opportunity here on this particular initiative to learn from all of the different mistakes that different locations have made over the years. And that's the real strength in being connected to these locations, because quite often, as you know, when you read business biographies, it's all about how successful the entrepreneur was. You very rarely hear from people in business who say, actually, I failed so many times and here's how I failed, And that's more interesting to my mind than finding out why Silicon Valley is successful. Let's find out what failed in Silicon Valley and hopefully avoid it at Skolkov.
But in the second part of our session, we'll have a chance to talk about more about Silicon Valley, because we'll have a representative. And now, Alexei, please.
Yeah, I just wanted to briefly to follow on Connor's answer to your question, Said. We have an office at 3000 Sand Hill Road, so that's a direct connection to Silicon Valley, and we do this together with Rosnan and Russian venture companies. So that's a concentrated effort to commit to a partnership with the venture capital, first of all, but Sasha Lubachev will speak to that more. And we've actually, in the course of last year, hosted three delegations of venture capitalists from the Valley at Skolkov. As for your question about foreign startups, we do better. Not only we invite the foreign startups, as Connor said, we invite researchers, which is the step before they become startups. Sasha talked to the importance of investment climate and how foreign companies, big companies, can make money for shareholders. We're talking about creating a favorable academic and research climate, which is the thing that will give birth to the startups here locally and with international participation. So what we do at Skolkovo Tech, we actually fund research efforts at world's best universities and connect them with Russian researchers, which we know are smart, but lack the skills to commercialize. So that's the trick, that's the magic formula we're following to achieve the result, and then Russian and foreign startups will appear at Skolkovo. And I have to tell you that that effort receives a lot of support and interest from those world's leading universities. In our first call for research center proposals, we've received over 130 white papers in a very short period of time from 30 countries and 360 universities around the world. And among those were six Nobel Prize winners and one Fields Medal participant who wanted to participate in creating those centers of research, education, and innovation at Skolkovo Tech. So that's our way of doing things or preceding that.